Hi kids, hi parents. I'm Shannon Terhune, the pastor at Raleigh Heights Baptist Church. I hope that you're experienced the love of Christ, and we love you and your families, and we want Jesus's gospel message to reach and know that you are loved. And these messages, these studies will be used by not only our church members, but everyone else to share the love of Christ. Thank you.
Guys, do you know what this is? This is an Etch-a-Sketch. Now, Miss Tracy grew up before cell phones and computers and video games and all of that stuff. So this was a toy that I played with a lot when I was little. I loved seeing what I could make on my Etch-a-Sketch. I loved seeing what pictures I could draw. Could I write words with it? As you twist these knobs, the line moves on the screen. It's so cool. I'm wondering, could I still make something on here? Could I make a picture of a boat? Let's see. All right, so let's check it out. Well, you can tell it's a boat, but when I look at it, I see my mistakes. Do you ever do that? When you work on something really hard and you should be proud of it or you should be excited, but you see your mistakes? Yeah, do you make mistakes? Miss Tracy makes mistakes every day. I don't like making mistakes, do you? Sometimes when I make mistakes, I feel embarrassed. Sometimes when I make mistakes, I feel like I might be upsetting somebody or letting them down. Or I might feel like I'm not good enough. So I wonder, have you ever made a mistake? Because not only do I make mistakes on my Etch-a-Sketch, I think I make mistakes every single day. And sometimes we make mistakes and it's no big deal. It's very easy to fix and we can just move right along. Sometimes we make big mistakes that can't be fixed. And those are the really tough ones. I remember one time when I was little, my family had gone to visit my grandparents. And my sister and I were playing in the room where we were staying and we got a little carried away. And we ended up breaking one of our grandmother's vases. Now you need to know, my grandmother had a beautiful home and she had lots of fancy things and everything was always neat and tidy. And we felt terrible. We were so worried that she was going to be so upset. What if somebody special had given her this vase? What if it was her favorite vase and we had broken it? What were we going to do? We had two choices. We could either lie about it, try to cover it up, hide the evidence so she didn't know about it or didn't find it until later. Or we could fess up and be honest and apologize and let her know that we broke the vase. And we decided to go ahead and be honest. And you know what she did? She forgave us. She didn't get upset. She didn't cry. She didn't yell at us. She told us that we were more important than that vase. A vase could be replaced. We couldn't, and she was thankful that we hadn't gotten hurt. When I remember that story about my grandmother from when I was little, I can't help but think about what God thinks of me. Now, in God's Word, we read about a lot of different people. And sometimes people think the Bible is full of stories of perfect people. But you want to know what? It's actually the opposite. The Bible tells us stories about people who made a lot of mistakes. But the Bible also tells us, one of my favorite verses is in 1 John. And it says that God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. Isn't that good news? That He knows we're going to make mistakes and He's ready to forgive us as long as we're ready to admit our mistake and ask Him for that forgiveness. And today I want to share with you a story about somebody from the New Testament. And this man made a lot of mistakes. Now, I don't know how much you know about the Bible, but let me give you a quick lesson. The Bible is divided into two sections. The first part is the Old Testament, and that is where we read about God creating the world. Sin came into the world and caused all sorts of problems. And we read about God's special chosen people, and we also read about how God promises that He is going to send somebody to fix the sin problem. The second part of the Bible is called the New Testament, and that's where we read about Jesus's life, who is the one who came to fix the sin problem. We read about His time on earth, when He went back up to heaven, and then the church and how the world changed after Jesus went back to heaven, and also gives us the promise that He's coming back one day. The story I want to share with you all today is from the New Testament, and it's about a man named Peter. Now, Jesus spent time with a lot of people, and we read stories about Him teaching to crowds of thousands of people. But Jesus had a small group of friends, 12 of them, that were called His disciples, and He spent a lot of time with them. They ate together. They prayed together. They went to church together. They saw Him do miracles. They saw all sorts of amazing things. And He knew that when He went back up to heaven, that they were going to help continue the work that He was doing. Now, Peter was one of these 12 friends of Jesus, one of His disciples. And I want to read to you from Matthew a verse about Peter. Peter got to see and be part of some amazing things that Jesus did. And Peter clearly knew that Jesus was this promised Messiah that God had told about. And in Matthew 16, Jesus said to him, "I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." Jesus knew that God had special plans for Peter. And even then, while he was still alive, he was already preparing this. And shortly before Jesus died on the cross, Jesus told Peter that he would deny him three times. Well, Peter was so upset by this, and Peter was adamant, "No, Lord, I would never do this." But you want to know what happened? Exactly what Jesus said. Peter did deny Jesus three times, and Peter felt terrible. That could have been the end of Peter's story. Peter could have decided, "This is one of those mistakes that can't be fixed. I've messed up. I'm done." But that wasn't the end for Peter. After Jesus died, he didn't stay dead. And we read a story in the book of Mark where some of Jesus' followers went to the tomb where Jesus was buried. And when they went there, Jesus wasn't there because he had already risen from the dead. But an angel was there to meet them and said, "Don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him? But go tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." Did you catch that? It didn't just say, "Go tell the disciples." It mentioned Peter by name. I love this verse because I think it's sort of that reminder that Peter needed. You know what, Peter? You made a mistake, but I'm not done with you yet. You are still one of my disciples. You still matter to me. I still have plans for you. Jesus spent 40 more days on earth And continuing to teach people, teach his disciples. And then after he went back up to heaven, in the next book, after about Jesus' life, there's a book of the Bible called Acts. And in Acts, we read about the early church. And do you know whose name came up again and again and again? That's right, it's Peter. And just like Jesus had told him, on this rock I will build my church. That's exactly how God used Peter. Because we read in the book of Acts how Peter then had the opportunity to preach boldly in front of large crowds of people. Peter even did some miracles, and we see the early church grow, and Peter is a big part of that. So guys, we need to remember, we are going to make mistakes. We don't like it. Nobody likes making mistakes. But God is faithful and just to forgive us. And that does not need to be the end of our story, just like it's not the end of Peter's story. God can still use us. We just need to let him do that. All right, let me pray for you. God, I thank you so much for Peter's story. I thank you for the reminder that we don't have to be perfect, and that God, your plan is perfect even through our mistakes. And God, you can and will do big things. And God, I pray for the kids who are watching this video, Lord, I pray that you've got big plans for them and that you will use them in special ways. God, we just love you so much. Thank you for loving us. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
This is the song, Remain in My Love. Now you're gonna start off with a walk. So you're gonna step, step, push down to your knees. One, two, step, step, push down. Two more times. Step, step, push down. Last time, step, step, push down. Now the song starts with As the Father Has Loved Me. So as the Father has loved me, I will also love you. Big circle, also love you. Then you're going to take it from your mouth. These are words from Jesus. These are words full of truth. Bring your hands down like you're praying. Then you're going to go into the chorus. So it says, he says, push out, remain in my love. Do it again. Remain in my love. He says, remain in my love. Then you're going to do a big circle with your arms. Remain in my love. Now we're going to go into the second verse. So as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Now back to your mouth again. These are words from our Savior, what he wants us to do. He says, now we're gonna go into the chorus again. Remain in my love, remain in my love. He says, remain in my love, remain in my love. Now into the bridge. You're gonna start with no better life than this, knowing who Jesus is, no better life than this, living in the love that he gives. So for that, you're gonna step out and you're gonna do your hands in a circle. So living in the love that he gives. Now you're gonna do it again. No better life than this, knowing who Jesus is, no better life than this, living in the love that he gives. And then you're gonna do a little jump and then starting to remain in my love. Remain in my love. Remain in my love. He says, remain in my love. Remain in my love. You're gonna do it one more time. And then at the end, when you go into your circle, remain in my love. And you're gonna end with your feet apart, looking up. And that's the song, Remain in My Love.
Hey everyone, I'm so glad you're here because I have a question about today's story about Peter.
In the story we just heard, Jesus told Peter, "I will build my church." So here's my question. What's a church? I have some pictures that I'm going to share with you, and I need you to tell me which one of these places is a church. You know, the place where we go to worship and learn about God. Okay, are you ready? Is this a church? No, it's a tree. Is this a church? No, that's a tent. Is this a church? No, it's a bridge. Is this a church? No, that's a cave. Is this a church? No, that's someone's house. What about this one? Is this a church? Yes. Awesome. You helped me find the right picture. Thank you. But wait, what if I told you that each of these other places is a church too? A tree? Yes. In Africa, some churches meet under a tree. A tent? Yes. Here is a church meeting in a tent in Europe. A bridge? Yes. In a big city in the United States, this church meets under a bridge. A cave? Yes. In China, the church must meet in secret, so a cave makes a good meeting place. A house? Yes. In many places around the world, the church meets in people's homes. Here's a house church in Iran. And a church right here in Chesapeake? Yes, of course. That's a picture of us. Each of these places is a church because a church really isn't a building at all. It's the people who gather together to worship God. The people are the church. We are the church. In fact, the word church comes from an ancient, really old Greek word. The word ekklesia means the called out ones. In other words, people. People who've been called out from their old lives of sin and who've put their faith and belief in Jesus. These people are the church. Let's remember today's story. When Jesus told Peter that he was going to build his church, he wasn't talking about a building. Jesus wanted more and more people to know him as their Savior and to live for him. And he wanted these people to meet together wherever they could to pray and to sing and to worship, to share meals and to help those in need and to share the message of Jesus, that even more people would come to know him and so that the church would keep growing. Jesus also told Peter that he wanted to use Peter to help him grow the church. Now, even though Peter, like us, wasn't perfect and had made a bad mistake, Jesus forgave him and asked him to help with this special job of building the church. So Peter spent the rest of his life helping the church to grow. He talked to many people in his neighborhood and in his city, inviting them and calling them out of their life of darkness and sin and showing them who Jesus was. And the church grew as more and more called out ones. Remember the Greek word for the church, ekklesia. As more and more people joined Peter and the other people who believed in Jesus. Peter knew that the church wasn't a building. Peter knew that the church was really the people, all the people who believed in Jesus as their Savior. And wherever those people would meet, there was a church. A tree? A cave? A house? Yes, because the church is built of people. Not wood, not stones, and not bricks. But Peter used the idea of building a building to help people understand exactly what the church is. In the time of Jesus and Peter, buildings were built out of stones, many stones layered one on top of the other. And every building needed a strong foundation. So buildings were built upon a big slab of rock, a rock so big and so strong that the building would stand firm. Look at all the different stones in this picture, different shapes and sizes and colors that make up this wall. This is how buildings were built back then. They were built of many stones put together. So Peter used this idea to describe the church. He wanted people to know that Jesus had asked him to help build the church. So what better way to do it than by calling people stones? Wait. Peter called people stones? What does that mean? It sounds awful. But it wasn't mean. Peter's own name means stone. Remember, every building needs a strong, solid foundation. So Jesus invited Peter to build the church upon the rock-solid foundation of Jesus himself. Another name for Jesus is our rock. Jesus wanted Peter to be the first of many stones built upon this foundation. And as Peter invited more and more people to become part of the church, he said that they too were like stones. And not just any old stone, living stones that Jesus would use to build and grow his church. Do you have your stone? Let's get it and look at it. Look at all the different sides of your stone. One side is blank. And on the other side is a heart. Which side of the stone do you think represents a living stone? You're right, the side with the heart. Are you a living stone? Do you believe in your heart that Jesus is God's Son who died on the cross to save you from your sins? If so, you are a living stone. You are a part of the church. You have been called out, and like Peter, you can help the church to continue to grow. How? Well, like Peter, you can call out to others and tell them who Jesus is. You can tell your friends, your family, and anyone that you meet that Jesus can change their hearts too. But what about all the people you don't know? People you'll never meet? People who live in faraway countries like in Africa or in Asia? Do they have someone calling out to them? Yes. Missionaries. Missionaries are people just like Peter and Jesus' other friends and disciples who help the church to grow. These men left their homes in Jerusalem to share the message of Jesus in other countries. See all the colors on this map? Those are all the places these missionaries went. Because they left home and moved to other places, the church continued to grow, and it is still growing today, because missionaries are willing to go. My husband and I are missionaries in Cuba. Cuba is an island not very far from Florida, but it is very different from the United States. Cuba is home to 11 million people. That's a lot of people. Sadly, many people in Cuba don't believe in God at all, or don't believe that Jesus is our Savior. They are not yet living stones. They don't have a heart for Jesus. So my husband and I have decided, like Peter, to spend the rest of our lives trying to share the truth of Jesus with the people of Cuba. We want them to become living stones. We want to see Jesus' church grow in Cuba. Do you want to see Jesus' church grow? Do you want to be like us and like Peter? You too can be a missionary, and you don't have to leave home and move away to a faraway country. You can be a missionary every day and everywhere. You just have to accept the mission. A missionary has an important mission. It's the same mission that Jesus gave to Peter. What is the mission? To help the church continue to grow by sharing with people the truth that Jesus is our Savior. He is the rock upon which we should build our lives so that we have a firm foundation. He wants to change us from ordinary stones into living stones. That is our mission, and as members of the church, we can all share the good news. Let's look at our stones one more time. After today's lesson, let's put our stones in a special place, and every time we see them, let's remember to pray. Let's pray for missionaries like me and my husband and other missionaries all around the world. Pray that God would use us to help build his church. And pray that God would use you too to help build his church right where you are so that more and more people can know who Jesus is. If you don't know Jesus, if you've never asked him to change your heart and make you a living stone, you can do that today. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the story of Peter and the church. I want to be a living stone that helps the church continue to grow. I know that I need Jesus to save me from my sins, and I want him to be my Savior. Lord, make me a missionary right where I live and help me to share about you with everyone I know. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Thank you for watching this episode of Raleigh Heights Baptist Church Virtual Vacation Bible School. Make sure to check out our other episodes on our YouTube page. God bless!